This is a 60s on 6 special presentation on Sirius XM. I'm Lou Simon, and we are talking about the Wrecking Crew, the real Wrecking Crew, and the Wrecking Crew documentary. And we're here with Chuck Berghofer, Hal Blaine, and Don Randi, and of course, Denny Tedesco, who put together the movie as well. And there's a lot of, we don't have to go into all of it, but everyone should know that when you use a piece of a recorded master, a record in a movie, you have to pay rights, clearance rights. You can't just use it for free. And, you know, Denny did it by the book, and wanted to pay each of these record companies, and it took years of private screenings that people would pay, you know, a donation at the door to come in and all over. And I mean, years of you doing this until you had the money to do it right.
And especially, he made sure that all the musicians got paid too. The
musicians got paid
as well.
Yeah, it's great, and that's why I wanted to make sure we celebrated it here. And I know that your dad is, you know, you speak Italian, Kvelling. He is very pleased about all this. And the number of sessions that you guys would do sometimes in a day, it's absolutely inhuman the way it worked. I mean, these sessions were about 3 hours long, Don?
Generally speaking, they were 3 hours, sometimes 4 hours.
And now you would use that answering service and you would book back-to-backs?
They would, unfortunately, that's the way we did it, because I don't think we were greedy. We just wanted to do everything that we could possibly could.
Was there a fear at all, if I start to say no to some stuff and stay home and play with the kids, some other keyboard player is going to come in and he may be good? I mean, was there that at all?
Not for me, because if they didn't use me, they could use Leon. They could use Leon Russell or Larry Knechtel, Al DeLore, Mike Rubini. There was a lot of very, very competent musicians, pianists, and we all worked. There was enough for everybody, more than enough. And it was great, because for that whole period of in the 60s into the 70s, we were busy as heck. It never stopped.
You know, when you see the film, Tommy Tedesco does one of the great situations about a guy getting a call and deciding, well, I'll be there eventually.
Doesn't Joe Osborne, was it?
Doesn't work that way.
Bill Pittman, the guitarist, yeah.
But
yeah.
if you see the film, you'll understand what we're talking about. You never turn anything down.
Yeah.
And we used to call it dovetailing. When you finish one session, right into another one. Producers wanted us. They knew we might be a little bit late.
Well, you had three sets of drums.
I was going to say, you had a drum roadie, right, that would go to the next studio and set your kit up for you.
He was always one set of drums in front of me and one set of drums behind me.
No, it's true.
While I was working, yeah.
That's right. With three sets, one that you're using, one that you just finished using, one that's waiting for you, and he was as busy as you were.
I had a dozen sets of drums, and he was constantly... Rick Fauché was a young man. Everybody knew him. He had keys to every studio, every alarm system. He could go into 20th Century Fox.
And the baked potato, because he did everything here.
Exactly.
In the beginning.
He could go in 4 o'clock in the morning, and he had the alarms, the keys for all the alarms, and he could set up whatever and go to the next job.
You know, I got to say something. Again, it goes back to work ethic, these guys. You know, growing up, my dad made sure our house, don't forget, this is before we had answering machines. It was only the answering service. So they would check constantly from work if they would call the answering service any calls. By the time Dad left Hollywood to get to the point where he got home in Northridge, the first line would be walking through the door, any calls. I mean, like, did the answering service call? It was about making sure you didn't miss a call. We had a rotary system in the house where there were three lines. It would go like a doctor's office. Because God help one of the kids if we were on the phone that long and we blew a job. Yeah, can you imagine? So it was a real work ethic. And then when we went on vacation, he would tell the answering service, I'm not available. I didn't say, well, I'm on vacation. I'm not available.
Not available. Yeah. Wow. Yeah, that's
never say you're on the road, ever.
No.
Well, first of all, your dad had the psychology down. Unbelievable. he just knew what to do at each moment. And one time we were at RCA, and we always parked right there in the building, you know. And all of a sudden, one day, no, you can't park there anymore. You have to park up the street, blah, 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 whatever it was. And when Tommy found out about it, man, I couldn't believe it. He just said, okay, if they don't park in the building, the date's over right now. Yeah. Well, they opened the thing, and we parked in the building, you know, with no problem. And the other thing he always did, my favorite thing, was they'd say, Tommy, can you make that a little bit more this or that? And he had a fake knob on his amp, and he turned around and he'd turn it. That's better. Stuff like that. I mean, he played that thing all the time.
He was part psychologist, part master
psychologist. Yeah.
We have some folks in the audience that I know would like to ask you some questions, and so let's go there, and please tell who you are and then your question for whomever or for the entire group. Okay.
I have a question.
Hang on a second. What do we have? Go ahead. Start again.
My name's Mike Wood, and my question is, these famous studios that were around, and some still are, that you guys played in, how important was the room sound? Did they all sound really great, or how important was the room sound to what you guys did? I'm curious about that.
Well, many of the hits that came out of Gold Star, that was an important room, very important. Capitol, some of the rooms at Capitol, you know, but they were very similar to the ones at RCA Victor. They were kind of on the same level.
It's still there. United is still, I mean, it's called United again, by the way.
We were just there, actually. And Western was right next door, which is now East West Studios. They were important, but I think more important, as important as the studios were, if you had the good engineers in those places, because they knew the rooms. They knew them probably better than anyone. And if you could match the two together, you know, that's what made it work.
Well, I have to put a feather in my cap for this one, because when I, you know, all of a sudden I was a rock and roll drummer, and I, just playing my rock and roll drums was seeping into other microphones, and I could play soft but it was still leakage. It was always leakage. So one day I sent Ricky, my drum tech, out to a department store and get the biggest beach umbrella you could get. And he brought it back, and we hung it on a big boom mic, and we cut off the wood so it wouldn't hit me in the mouth. And all of a sudden, when they lowered it over me, I was like in a little drum booth. RCA bought one immediately. Columbia bought one. Capitol bought one. They all ran out and bought these because they all of a sudden they had a booth. So necessity is often the mother of invention.
So you created the isolation booth for drummers?
I'm still isolated.
he also created the tom-toms all the way around.
Well, you know, now that's
that wasn't happening until hell.
Tuned, you know, tom-toms that, I mean, and we can hear them on so many records, and I immediately say, that's Hal Blaine.
Also, when the electronic drum, the first syndromes that came out, he was the first one to have it. That boom,
Ballard.
Boom.
Joe Ballard was the inventor.
And Hal said, you got to hear this crazy thing. And I used it a number of times for effect on a film and for a Radio Shack commercial that we did. But he was innovative. He had it before anyone did. He also would listen.
He's patting my back. It's all right.
Listen to a track. Now, this is unusual. There's a couple of guys that will do it because of him. He'd hear tonality, and he'd tune his drums to be sympathetic to the tonality of what was going on. Not many guys do that. They're bangers, you know. They're nothing wrong with that. But his was more sympathetic to what the song was, what the sound was, what the melody was, because he can sing. He won't tell you that, but I know that.
Sophisticated percussion, we'll call that.
You don't understand. When you told the story about I suffer with that CRS, can't remember shit. Excuse my French.
That's not.
What was the thing that he used to do about tuning?
Oh.
Turn up the volume.
Right, right.
Guys would come to me and they'd say, and I always knew when it was a new engineer, because he would say, excuse me, drummer, or excuse me, Mr. Blaine, we feel like we could use some more snare on your drum. And I'd say, certainly. Now I'm behind the barrier and they can't see me. And I'd reach into my trap case and make some noise. And then I would come back to the drum with the drum key and I would make noises, you know, like dum, dum, dum. And then I'd say, how's that for you? And they'd say, perfect, just what we wanted. Tricks of the trade that always worked.
Do we have time for him to tell a story about his singing?
About house singing?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
You know where I'm going, Don. My favorite story. Set him up.
We are on the road.
Oh.
With Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, Sammy Davis Jr., and Nancy Sinatra. And this is in 1968 when Hubert Humphrey was running for president. And Frank Sinatra and that group were still Democrats. So we're out. We're in Minneapolis, St. Paul. And they have a blue law on Sunday where you don't drink till God knows when, or you don't drink at all. And a lot of the restaurants just close down at certain hours. And our show was early in the evening on a Sunday. And we finished, and we came back, and the restaurant had just closed. So everybody was going away. They're going to the White House for burgers. This one's going this one for burgers. And Hal and I were in the same room.
White Castle.
White Castle, that's right. That's White Castle. So we're in the room, and Hal says, I'm starving. I said, I am too. He says, well, why don't we try calling room service? I said, they already closed 20 minutes ago. He says, take a shot. Said, whatever. He says, tell them it's for Sinatra. So I'm looking. I said, are you out of your mind? He says, no, try it. So I did it. I called down, and the chef answers, fortunately, and he gets the head chef. He says, just a second. I said, I'm calling for Mr. Sinatra. Frank would like to have dinner. Just one second, and he gets the chef, and he comes on the phone. He says, you know, we really closed, but for you guys, we'll be glad to do anything you want. So I said, it's just for two of us, Mr. Sinatra and myself, you know. So we order steaks, baked potatoes, drinks, rolls, you know. And he said, it'll take about 25 minutes. So me not thinking, I said, fine, that'll be great. And I hang up the phone, and then I suddenly realized, we don't have Frank Sinatra, you know. So Hal says, don't worry about it. So the guy comes 25 minutes, there's a knock on the door. Hal jumps up, runs in the bathroom, turns the shower on, and starts singing, come fly with me, fly.
Let's fly away.
And the guy comes in, and I'm dying. I want to laugh, but I can't laugh. But we're pulling it off. And so it's an African-American gentleman who was dying to meet Mr. Sinatra. And he's standing there looking, what's going on? What's going on? And he says, I said, he's taking a shower. He'll be out. And I realized he didn't bring the rolls. I said, oh, you forgot the rolls. Stupid me. I said, you forgot the rolls. He goes racing back, comes back, and Hal runs back in the shower and is still singing, come fly with me. And then I try to pay him, and he won't accept any money from us because it's for Frank. So he leaves. We were able to tip him, thank God. And we finish eating dinner. We're the only ones that ate. So I said, that was fantastic. So Hal says, it's not over. He says, we have to put our trays and everything outside the door so that when everybody comes back, they know we ate and nobody else did. That's what he pulled off.
Come fly with me, let's fly away.
And the picture goes right past me, past Hal, to Glenn, into the booth, like where you folks are sitting. And there is Bruce Johnston on one side, Terry Melcher on another, and what looks like to be Jesus Christ in between them. Only Jesus Christ was Charles Manson.